We started out tonight with a couple of moments from the backstage press events. You know, after they pick up their Oscars, they go directly backstage and they meet with reporters from around the world. And I'm just always so shocked by how completely asinine the reporters
how
are.
How just
backstage.
Stupid. I mean, just the dumbest questions. I mean, even dumber than the White House press corps, if that's possible. I mean,
it's incredible because I've applied to cover the Oscars. I mean, I know what you have to go through, like the long ass application, and you have to be very specific about your intentions and what you need and what you're requesting. And how do these people get in? They're moronic.
It is the press. I mean, those questions, especially I just the other day watched the one with Jennifer Lawrence, and her facial reactions were classic. I mean, she's like, "You've got to be kidding me, really?" And what was that last question about the blood, the bones? What the hell?
Who was that asked of first off?
It's Tarantino.
Oh, okay.
Good luck with that. Wow. I mean,
wow. Anyway, so that was, I mean, just pure calamity, man. I mean, come on. Let us go to the Oscars for crying out loud. I mean, we'll ask a question in English or, you know, something that's understandable, you know. Not, you know, are you all flesh and blood or do you think you have bones?
Yeah. I don't get, I don't,
and we
don't
would be
understand that.
You know, a real question, not a.
Yeah.
Not something that was that's designed to tear you down or make you feel embarrassed or whatever. God.
Jennifer Lawrence, do you think that you have bones? Would you like mine?
I mean,
anyway,
weird.
Okay, so it's been a few days, and honestly, I mean, the Twitter like had millions upon millions of people commenting during the ceremony. It was a record number, and people have done, you know, Monday morning quarterback on this ceremony already. Yeah. And most of it concerns the host, Seth MacFarlane, more than the actual ceremony. I haven't read much about the actual ceremony. It's all
no, I haven't
Seth
either.
Well, I'll try to, you know, in my wrap-up, you know, I did start off with Seth MacFarlane in the first three paragraphs, but the rest of it's about the actual ceremony.
Yeah, yeah.
And the awards.
But everything else I've read hasn't really.
It's about that and the Onion tweet during the show.
Right, which I didn't even mention that.
Why dignify it? That's what I hate. The people like here on one of the listservs I'm on, that's all they talked about. These emails. I'm like, why don't you like send about like, you know, possible jobs or something? Why are you guys just fixated on this? I mean, like 30 emails in one day on this chain about, oh, how we should boycott the Oscars and just forget about it. I mean, really? Come on.
It's dumb.
Oh, it's just stupid. I mean, look, I'll be honest with you. I mean, the thing with the Onion, that was just stupid. I know they're satirical, they're great, but that was just stupid. Whoever thought that was a genius idea was dumb. About MacFarlane, you get what you pay for, you know? You know that, those guys know that going in, that's what they're going to get.
Well, you know what you're going to get, but you also know what you're going to get the day after.
Yeah, I mean, but look, it gave them what they wanted, ratings. It gave them a boost in the ratings. But look, they're gonna do something else next year, and they're gonna keep doing this.
My point is that, you know, this whole idea of, you know, the whole Oscars being this launching ground or some kind of testing site for the great comedic minds of the day is just like a pointless dead end, you know, because comedy is so subjective anyway that you're not really going to be able to really satisfy people on that, everybody on that front anyway.
You can't.
But also, it's not really I mean, you know, honestly, it's not really a funny ceremony, or it's, there's nothing really funny about it, really. You know, you really have to stretch for any. I mean, I know that it's easy to tear down, you know, this, you know, big bloated thing we call the movies and everything, and you know, you think that it's easy, but it's not really that easy, you know, and it's not really the forum for it, really. I mean, the thing about Bob Hope and Johnny Carson was that they were good because they were funny, but they were also respectful at the same time of the boundaries of the award show, and they knew that the award show was really there to celebrate the movies first and foremost, and not for some, you know, ego scratch. But you're right, they're going to keep on doing it, and they're just going to keep on doing it, and if they think that Honey Boo Boo can, you know, be a good host next year and make a good rating splash and help them put some shovels in the ground for that new
that Monday morning is going to be dreadful. let's go back. I mean, look, Seth MacFarlane, Chris Rock, John Stewart, David Letterman, they don't like it when they are, how should we, the butt of the joke. They do have a very thin skin. The business that you need, you technically should have the thickest skin, but when it's turned on them, they don't like it. And this time with Seth MacFarlane, I think a lot of people were really offended by "We saw your boobs" skit. I mean, this really, I didn't realize this till Monday morning. This really outraged a lot of women. I mean, I don't know. And the thing,
well,
with this,
I mean, when you're talking about who needs to be thick-skinned,
yeah,
I mean, we're talking about journalists and everybody else writing about it. I don't see where any celebrities admitted that they were offended by it.
Yeah, anything. I agree. I agree with you 100%.
Well, actually, Jane Fonda came out and said she hated it in her blog.
Oh, did she? Well,
yeah.
Is that before or after? I mean, she looks like she's 40.
Well,
I mean,
you know, the thing is, let me just say this about this. I found it offensive too, and I like nudity in movies and everything, but when you go into the Oscars and you're expecting like some sort of again a celebration of movies and of the year's achievements and everything like that. Nobody wants to be in there and feel like they're the butt of any kind of joke, specifically a series of jokes, not just the boob jokes, but it went on all night long about women's bodies, as that's what they're defined by. And then if women do come out and say, you know, a lot of women, probably actresses, have probably not said anything because they're afraid it's going to make them look stuffy or humorless or something like that.
Right, right.
And what happens then is that it makes them complicit in their own objectification, really.
Well, and three of the actresses were. I mean, they didn't have any problem with, you know, Charlize and Jennifer Lawrence and whoever else they cut to. They had no problem actually being part of the skit.
Right.
Well, I do have to admit that when they cut to Jennifer Lawrence and she did the big thumbs up for not being nude in movies, I thought that was pretty funny. But
you know what, though? But it's the whole nature of an award show is kind of an ego massage.
Right,
yeah,
of course.
They're privileged people patting themselves on the back all night.
I
agree.
So there is an element of, I'm sure a lot of people at home want to see them being good-naturedly ribbed. Now, I'm not saying that Seth MacFarlane did it good-naturedly. I'm just saying that there might be a place for that if you put a host on the show,
mm-hmm.
and you're trying to get some humor out of it. I mean, it's a show. You want people to laugh and be thrilled and be moved.
Yeah, but what makes
everything. This
award show any different from any other award show, like the Grammys, for instance? They don't have some host on the Grammys making some Chris Brown jokes or whatever.
Sure they do. I mean,
no,
they don't have
a host on the Grammys. First of all, I mean, if
they do
have a host, it's a music host. It's not a
right. Hasn't Chris Rock hosted the Grammys before?
I don't know because
I guarantee if Chris Rock hosted the Grammys, you know, he's going to rib somebody.
Well, I just don't think that's the way they work. I mean, I can't ever remember seeing a Grammys that was hosted by a comedian and they came out and made jokes about everybody. It's just, they've got too many fish to fry in that particular ceremony because they've got a lot of performances to come up, so they don't need some asshole coming up there doing this fucking
He's won three Grammys. He's won three Grammys, but he hasn't hosted the Grammys.
Right, okay.
Just to clear
But they just don't do that there.
Because the music community is so respectful.
Let me say something, though, about Seth. It was basically the three shows he does. It was basically, it almost seemed like all recycled from Family Guy. I mean, it just seemed like all almost outtakes of Family Guy. But let me just say something. It doesn't, Jamie, I think you said this, it doesn't matter who the host is. This show still has a huge problem. It dies. This show just comes to a grinding halt and has a hard time until, like, you get some surprises or you get some speeches or something. It's just really bad. It's still, they don't know how to fix this show.
Well, in terms of being a show, I don't know how they fix that.
Yeah.
In terms of representing all 24 categories, I don't know how they fix that.
Yeah.
Because they're always going to have to do the categories that, you know, Joe Schmo in Indiana doesn't care about, like animated short and documentary short and, you know, best makeup and all that kind of stuff. I mean, you got to do it. I mean, that's the award ceremony. And I don't know how you can liven that up for people that are rabid movie fans. You know?
Right.
It's a necessary.
I don't think that there is any way. So you just need to abandon those people.
Well, I don't think you need to abandon those people. I think we can get rid of some of the musical numbers. So I thought the thing about the musical, I thought that the tribute to the musical thing of the last decade, I would have gotten rid of that. Because we're not talking about great film. I mean, I like Jennifer Hudson, I like Dreamgirls, but it's just too much. I thought where the music actually came in was the two Bond numbers were great, and the Bond montage. I think that saved the show in terms of non-awards-related stuff.
Well, of course, the highlight of the night was Shirley Bassey.
Yeah, I mean,
we
that
all
really
agree
is
with that.
The highlight. I mean,
you know.
But you could have cut that. You're absolutely right. You could have cut that musical montage out and actually made time for performances of the other two nominees.
Yeah,
for
I was like,
song.
What the hell was up with that? Mm-hmm. I mean,
exactly.
I mean,
I would agree with
and
that.
And they haven't done that in a couple of years, I think. They haven't performed the songs.
Yeah. They definitely didn't do it last year, but they did it the year that Jai. I think the last year might have been the Jai-ho year. From Dog. But, you know, I learned that, I didn't know this, but the producers this year were actually two of the co-producers or executive producers of Chicago. So that's why you had coming in twice in the ceremony.
well, yeah. And they also produced the show Smash on TV.
Right.
So, I mean, it was clear that the musical theme was in their wheelhouse, and all the other stuff wasn't really in their wheelhouse. Because for me, the ceremony felt very awkward a lot of times, and then a musical piece would come up, and I'd start to perk up a little bit for the most part.
Yeah.
And I thought Shirley Bassey, obviously, the high point of the night. I almost wish they hadn't announced her. Being present at the Oscars before it actually happened, I would have liked to have been surprised.
Right.
Same thing goes for Streisand. Even though, you know, you got to announce something like that, so the female demographic might tune in to see it. You
yeah.
know? Hey, Streisand's on this for the first time in 38 years. Make sure you watch. You know.
I mean, you know, I have to say that I did think Jennifer Hudson was really good in the show too.
Oh no, she's good. Don't get me wrong, but it just seems like. You know, and I don't know about this. You know, look, I'm not a ham-handed
kind of thing. You know that.
And
that
I'm not
famous.
A huge Streisand fan, but that's just me. I've never been a big Barbra Streisand fan.
Me neither.
And I was just like kind of yawned at that point.
I'm not a Streisand
well, no,
fan either, but I recognize her status.
Oh, of course.
You know, I recognize that that's a special moment.
Oh,
but
yeah.
You know, but Hudson sang that song the year she was nominated, didn't she?
I'm not really sure about that.
I don't remember.
But I do know that, all that jazz number was done on stage and that year. And then they had the Les Miserables thing, which, you know, that was sort of interesting. I mean, you know, one thing about that was actually a little bit more energetic than anything I saw in the movie that they actually made me say, boy, if the movie had been this good, it would have been great, you know.
Yeah,
but
yet more incentive for me not to watch that movie. If that's the case.
It's true.
Yeah. I was like, really, you're going to follow up Jennifer Hudson with Russell Crowe? Are you serious? And I really think they got the order mixed up. I think, you know, as big as Les Miserables was, because all the people came out, I understand the reasoning for making that the third of the three musical numbers, but the showstopper was Jennifer Hudson.
Yeah.
At that point, you know, in that segment, because you're not going to get a better finale than that one.
Right.
I honestly don't think that she did that song in the year that she won for.
No, she I guess she wouldn't have, because it wouldn't have been nominated for anything.
Exactly.
Pre-existing song, yeah.
Yeah.
What do you guys think of that's, you know, that's our take on the actual show and the host. But,
right.
What do you think of the actual winners? What surprised you?
Well, the show started off with a surprise for me, and pleasant one for Christoph Waltz, you know.
That caught me off guard. I could have sworn it would be Tommy Lee Jones. I mean, he was smiling before. I mean, he was actually. Yeah.
I think he got schooled by his management to say, come on, smile, won't you?
Got a new movie coming out. Smile, you're playing
like
MacArthur.
An animatronic puppet. He's like, cue smile, cue the smile.
I thought it was going to be Robert De Niro, honestly.
He looked pissed the rest of the night.
Although, you know, he was, you know, he looked happy when Jennifer Lawrence won.
Of course.
But yeah.
Well, let it be said that I stuck by my prediction of Christoph Waltz.
Really?
Wow, that was very good. That was very good on your part. Very optimistic.
Did you have some kind of last-minute thing that you thought of?
That's the one that I waited until the last minute, because I have an Oscar pool that we do at work the Friday prior.
Right.
And I filled that category out last. And in the end, it was just the fact that De Niro hadn't won anything the whole season.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Right.
That was the thing that turned it for. Okay. Wow. Well, you know.
But what a great moment that would have been.
I was happy to see him win.
I would have been. I mean, it's a great. It is one of those rare. It is a very rare performance lately. You know, in his post. I mean, if we really in the 21st century, he is not given that many. You know, great. This is like maybe his first good performance of the century. Who would ever thought he would say that about him? But that's the sad truth, that this is really the first really great, like, why we love Robert De Niro kind of performance. It's nice that he was recognized for it, but it was a tough category.
It was one of the toughest. You know, actually backstage, Howard Stern sent David Arquette. Because David Arquette actually adores Howard Stern. He sits in on his show a lot, and he convinced David Arquette to go and ask jokey questions in the press room. And here he is, this actor that's been working in the business, you know, and not epic great movies or anything. I mean, he's a goof, but he's been working like 15 years or whatever it's been. He's known and recognizable. They only called on him once. Like, he got out one question, and then he was unable to ask anything else. And it was of Christoph Waltz. Christoph Waltz walked backstage, and he said, man, you've won like two Oscars, and I've acted a long time. I haven't won a single one. And Christoph Waltz said, well, I won my first one when I was 37. And Arquette said, yeah, I'm 41. but then he said, given the theme of Django, what do you think about the possibility of a black pope? You know, and when you...
What the...
Yeah, when you know, like, the questions that Howard Stern had, has, like, Baba Booey, not Baba Booey, but Stuttering John asked years ago,
yeah.
The terribly offensive, jokey questions, that one's actually pretty minor.
yeah.
And Christoph Waltz answered it very seriously, but they refused to call on David Arquette again.
I would refuse, too. I mean,
and Arquette was like, I'm going to be so blackballed from this industry where I work.
He should only be allowed... If he was doing all the questions in his, you know, from Scary Movie, you know,
yeah.
Officer Doofy, then I'd say every question. But,
and yet, that was a better question than, do you think humans have bones?
Yes,
you know,
it was. More relevant than all.
You could not
ways.
Tell the satirical question from the real questions. That's how bad those reporters were backstage.
God, there's that was just surreal. I mean.
Yeah. Yeah, so I like Christoph winning. The favorite moments for you guys among the winner speeches, what were they?
Well, obviously for me, Tarantino's, but I want to say I didn't like that the Life of Pi visual effect guy was just blatantly cut off. I mean, because he had...
Well, I guess we have
to
talk about this here, don't we?
Yeah.
I didn't like the way... it was very rude this year, you know, when they were telling... And playing Gone with the Wind for Quentin Tarantino off? I mean, really?
That was pretty bad.
Awful.
And then I don't like the use of the Jaws theme, because I know... I guess that was picked as sort of a joke or whatever, but it's not really...
Well, it's disrespectful to cut somebody off.
It is very... It was this year, they were really... disrespectful, I felt.
Well,
I mean,
especially with the Jaws theme, though, you know, it gets so, you know, distracting. You can't, you know, it's better if they just start with just soft little, you know, nothing music, and then, you know, bring it up to a crescendo or whatever. But you know, with the Jaws theme, it's just like shut up already. They might as well have the guy say shut up
and
already.
And that was a weird,
you know,
that was a weird thing too. The fact that the orchestra was in an entirely different location.
Yeah,
that
I didn't. I was not aware of that until they mentioned it. I was like, oh my god.
That was strange. And I'm wondering, did they do that just because they wanted to bring the audience seating closer, and they needed to remove the orchestra pit, or does the codec? You know, I don't know. I would think
that
would be it.
Yeah, it must be something like that.
Because when Jackman hosted,
it,
the audience was up close, and I don't remember the orchestra there, where they were located that night when he hosted.
As far as the visual effects guys go, they were cut off, like the mic was cut off, and it was done very artlessly, I'll say that, because they were right in the middle of the thing, but... If you were the visual effects guys and you had something to say about this issue, and people were out there, you know, milling it out and protesting this issue, instead of thanking all of the executives and the director and talking about the special effects are very important in this movie, and then, because I looked at their speech and everything, yes, they don't have a lot of time. Yes, nobody does on that technical level. But, you know, then he went all down the line, thanked all the executives and all the coworkers and everything, thanked mom and dad and his wife and daughters or whatever. And then he starts getting into the issue and everything. And then it's all, and then now everybody's mad because, you know, it got cut off. Why wouldn't you have just started a little bit more artfully and said, you know, well, we worked really hard on this, but now we're going bankrupt, and it's because of blah, 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 and then say
well,
it right there.
Because he probably thought he'd have an opportunity to get that out.
Yeah,
and
I think that's why.
And secondly, I mean, when you win an Oscar, I mean, your mind kind of leaves your body anyway.
I would yes, you're right.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's
But they cut him off right when he was about to bring up that issue, which led to kind of a thought that, you know, they sabotaged that because they knew he'd probably bring it up, and they didn't want him to. Because, just to clue people in, there was a big effects house that was closed down that worked on I think, Life of Pi and a
right.
lot of other great high-profile special effects-driven movies. And like 400 or 500 of those laid off employees were protesting out front of the Oscars,
mm-hmm.
and so that's what he was speaking to.
And,
you know, we need to value the visual effects artists that actually make movies profitable.
Yeah, and this is a very big thing because a couple years ago, you remember the remake of Piranha? That Canadian special effects house was never paid. They were never paid for that, at least at the time the movie came out. I don't know if they later. But this is not – this is – special effects industry, while, yes, it's beautiful, it's everything, there's a lot of hard work goes into that. They do not make a lot of money. Don't be fooled and thinking because the movies cost a lot that they get paid a lot. They are – a lot of those jobs, unfortunately, now are outsourced, like the rotoscoping and other things like that are outsourced. They really – take a really, like, horrible is practice of really outsourcing the work and trying to really just bleed the special effects houses make them work harder and faster for less money, which just seems to be the American way in the last, like, 30 years. But it's really disingenuous. It's really disgusting. And I wish you would have brought it up earlier because I think that, you know, you need – that is the best platform, regardless if you get in trouble or whatever. It needs to be something that needs to be brought out because people are getting – there's a whole industry that's getting screwed over.
I wonder if there's always – a protest out in the Oscars because if you think about it, I mean, it's a worldwide audience. The Super Bowl is the only thing that really compares to it as an annual event that draws a billion people worldwide.
Mm-hmm.
But I wonder if there's always a form of protest outside, and we just don't know about it. Because the last protest I remember was Mel Gibson and the Braveheart and the discrimination against homosexuals for Mel Gibson. And I remember that.
I mean, do you remember seeing footage of that and the coverage of the Oscars or the red carpet or anything?
Yeah, I remember they did something to an Oscar statue, and it was like Mel Gibson, no heart instead of Braveheart, and you know, it was. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, they did a good job of covering it up because I had no idea that there was any kind of protest out there. And I mean, you know, I have to say, you know, I've been kind of like, yeah, you know, but if this you know, on this issue, you know, been like, but if this is analogous, if I'm now understanding it correctly, to, like, the writers not getting paid when something goes into profit. You know, like that Art Buchwald thing that was done with Coming to America.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
Where the thing made, you know, $600 million in profit, and Art Buchwald still couldn't get any of the points.
Or like Forrest Gump. Remember Forrest Gump? They said never made a profit. Winston Groom tried to get it.
Yeah.
Right. So this is sort of analogous to that. It's like, you know, they don't get any profit sharing when the you know, something like Life of Pi hits $700 million worldwide or whatever it's done. Is that the case? Basically,
it's a lot of things. But look, unless you're like above the line or whatever, or unless you're basically the studio, you're getting screwed. It isn't.
Yeah.
When we think, the general public thinks of, if you're in the movies, you make a lot of money. It's like anything else. There's like 1% that does very well, and there's a 99% that is, you know, this is a second. They need a second job. You know what I mean?
Well,
it's like
Life of Pi was actually the highest grossing of all the Best Picture nominees worldwide.
Oh, okay. I was not aware of that. Okay.
Some like $600 million worldwide.
It's over $600 million at this point.
But I'm waiting for them to say, it hasn't made a profit yet.
Yeah, they probably would. And Seth MacFarlane actually told a joke about that. But, you know, but my point is about cutting off the acceptance speeches, which are the most important part, really, of the awards ceremony.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you want to see who the winner is, and you want to hear their acceptance speech. And that's award show 101. I mean, that's the very basic foundation. You cut out the 25-minute opening. You cut out the useless 15-minute musical montage.
Uh-huh.
You know, you cut out all of that awkward, terribly unrehearsed presenter banter. I mean, most of it just flopped terribly. It was, you know.
Oh, I mean, like,
up and
Paul
give
Rudd
the winners
and
a chance.
Melissa, Paul Rudd and Melissa McCarthy or whatever. That was like a big thud. And so were all the Avengers up there. That didn't work at all either. I was like,
Samuel Jackson was going to kill someone because he was still pissed off that he wasn't nominated. I thought he was going to. He looked really pissed off.
True.
I mean,
he did. He did.
And he normally looks so happy.
Yeah. He's like Pollyanna up there.
Yeah, he's like Tommy Lee Jones.
But.
Anyway, so yeah, I mean, that's always my complaint. I mean, don't play these people off. They just give them the clock, and they won't go very long after. And then they even had, I think they had volunteer, no, they had winners. They did this contest where college kids were chosen to be present at the Oscars, and I think they were actually the ones that were on stage and ushered people off.
Yes. Yeah. They're like all filmmakers that were, put into a contest.
Which is great. These are wannabe filmmakers.
Right.
Getting a world stage amongst the people that they dream of working with one day, and the Oscars gives them the job of pushing them off stage when their speech goes too long. That's
right.
Brilliant. These people are absolutely going to want to employ these kids for ruining their moment.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, what's the thinking there?
Well, my guess is, that most people don't, to be fair, most of the celebrities, I think, would not hold that against them. But you're so right about, just let the thing play out and cut some of the other stuff. And by the way, can we go ahead and add one more minute to the memoriam thing? So we can get rid of this whole lobbying thing and do a better job. I mean, look, TCM does a terrific job of doing an in memoriam thing every single year. And they do a 5-minute piece that has a lot of room to breathe, a lot of other stuff going
right.
on besides just clips of the people who passed away. And so you could easily just get that down to, 3 minutes. 3 minutes is not that long, and it's interesting. It's interesting, It's an interesting, fascinating sort of look at that. And it's getting to be something that's really popular, that people really like. So why not take a cue now and say, hey, listen, maybe we should go a little bit longer because now we have to have this committee now that – fields all these people who are family members who are putting, lobbying for their deceased relative who was famous, Andy Griffith didn't get in there or
was
whatever.
Is he the main one that everyone's upset about that was omitted, Andy Griffith?
He was the one that I was the most upset about.
Oh, my God, that's right. He was. Oh, my God. Oh, dear.
But then
that's
there was
horrible,
also
Ann
Rutherford, who was the last living cast member of Gone with the Wind. She wasn't in there.
Also, the guy who created Yoda was not.
Oh, yeah.
He wasn't in there.
So, there were a lot of people that they missed. And, I know that that's going to be inevitable, and you're never going to be able to. But, come on, let's just go ahead and make it a little longer, all right? It's okay. We could take another minute. We have to sit through 1 minute of a sock puppet thing.
I'm gonna see what Aaron thinks about the Oscar thing.
I love it.
This is funny.
I should not answer the phone. Come on, Aaron, come
through.
A live phone call. Come on. He's probably thinking it's a bill collector or something with this number. Aaron, we're calling you live from the show. We want to know your thoughts on the Oscars. So if you get this message in the next couple of minutes, call us back.
Call us back, please.
Okay.
Yo, Aaron.
Anybody else you want to call? Yeah.
Amazing. Here's the amazing thing. Roger Deakins still goes home a loser.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I was really hoping. I really thought, okay, this is it. I can't begrudge Claudia Miranda, but I just thought maybe, just maybe. Come on, Roger. It's the most beautiful Bond movie ever made. I mean, come on.
And
just for Movie Geeks United, though, for the past 2 years in a row, we've interviewed the Academy Award-winning cinematographer for Oscar season.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And also the music and the composer too. Who?
So screw Roger Deakins getting screwed over. Just think about us.
I know. I'm thinking about.
Well,
that.
Maybe we can get if Roger Deakins comes on the show, he's guaranteed an Oscar. If that's the way you pitch
I think that's the way we sell it, man. Next Oscar season, we're going to go out to all the cinematography nominees, and we're going to go, look, you're basically effing yourself if you don't agree to do our show.
Yeah, if you don't come on our show, man, you're not going to win.
You might as well not rent that tuxedo, man. Yeah,
by the way, how about you asked the question, you know, if we thought there was going to be a tie, and there was.
There was. It was shocking.
Yes, which was shocking because we broached that subject Sunday on our pre-Oscar show. And I'll be darned, it happened. And the thing is, nobody believed it because it was in the middle of a Mark Wahlberg TED presentation. Somebody
he actually
was
had
joking.
To say, no BS.
Yeah, yeah, that's something else. And there have been 5 ties, I believe, in Academy history. And so extremely rare.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was very neat, you know, very neat.
It's more rare than Jack Nicholson passing up an opportunity to come onto an underage girl, underage actress.
Oh, that was a very funny clip.
It was, yeah. He had a little flirtation with Jennifer Lawrence. And I was actually really happy to see Jack Nicholson at the ceremony because he hasn't been there in a couple of years, and he's the closest thing we have to Hollywood royalty, Jack Nicholson. So.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I'll agree with you there, yeah, definitely.
And he was very Nicholson-y up there, you know, like, you know.
The croaky voice saying stuff that makes no sense. I mean, he was.
Did anyone expect that? I did not expect that, the First Lady. I knew nothing about that. That's
true. They kept that under wraps.
Yeah, that was the only thing they kept under wraps, really.
And I thought it was wonderful. I thought she did a great job. I have no beef with her doing that. More power to her, you know?
Yeah, it was good. I thought it was fine. You know, I mean, I had no complaints with that.
Of course, half the country that already doesn't like the fact that, you know, the liberal Hollywood pats themselves on the back on this night. I'm sure the First Lady gave them even a greater distaste.
Oh, you know, they did. They hate. I don't know what it is. Well, I do know what it is, but I mean, I just think it's disgusting.
But
give
with that being
break.
Said, in the 80s, Ronald Reagan opened up the show, Republican president, obviously, and also an actor.
Yeah, notice they never bring that up. They never, you know, you have to remind them, oh, wait a second, your boy was, you know, the Second Coming, by the way, was, you know, an
actor. He was
actor.
Not only an actor, but he was the president of the Actors Union. Well, I had another surprise. Maybe the biggest surprise of the night for me was Brave winning for Best Animated Feature.
Yeah.
I thought that was an upset. I thought that was a massive upset, and it does not deserve it. I mean, it really, it is a weak movie.
You were railing about it on Sunday, and, you know, and I mean, deservedly so, from what I understand, even though I haven't actually seen it, but, I don't know, over Wreck-It Ralph.
You had, really? I mean, I didn't see, I haven't seen Wreck-It Ralph, but I would have given it to, but from all accounts, that was a more, people liked that more. I mean, no one walked, a lot of people were really disappointed in Brave. When we had Keith Ulick on, he had seen it, and he thought it was, you know, so, I mean, and it looked from the trailer, it looked, oh, this could be really good, and you're watching it, and you're like, oh, my God, you know, what the hell?
Yeah,
that was big upset.
Okay, I want to read something. 2 more things we'll do this show. Steve Pond, who is a writer for
The Wrap, he writes for
The Wrap. He wrote an article listing 10 things to remember from a long, strange award season. So I'm going to bring this up. We'll go through these, and then I want to go through some potential Oscar nominees for next year. He listed the Doc Branch shakes things up, 10 moments that stood out for better or worse in the award season. January of last year, the Academy announced new rules for Best Documentary Feature Oscar. Remember that? Which screeners of all eligible films will be sent to the entire branch. The entire branch will have an opportunity to vote on them,
right,
which could explain why the audience favorites Searching for Sugar Man won. Another disappointment that Rodriguez didn't show up. But I like that they mentioned why he didn't show up, and that
that made me think.
Okay, I get it.
Yeah, it makes total sense.
Sundance gets beastly. It's about the whole influence of Sundance, and Sundance, year after year, more often than not, plays such a role in the Oscar race.
Well, it definitely always throws in at least one or two movies, you know, that figure big, very big, you know.
Everyone that still says, you know, how relevant is Sundance anymore in the midst of all these other film festivals across the world that are getting attention, just look at the Oscar race year after year. I mean, from Little Miss Sunshine to Winter's Bone to Beasts of the Southern Wild, I mean, they're still relevant.
Right.
Yeah, and Searching for Sugar Man, because it opened up the festival this year. So.
Amour premiering, I think it premiered at the Cannes Film Festival.
Right.
That getting acclaim early on last year. Argo's Canadian Caper. Ben Affleck's Argo came out of its sneak preview screening at the Telluride Film Festival, riding an avalanche of buzz, and it went over like gangbusters when it had its official premiere in Toronto in September. I mean, the film festival circuit, and we're going to see it pretty soon when Cannes strikes back up. We're going to get a great idea of what's in the running in next year's Oscars. From that.
Well, I mean, this year we have the second year in a row that the Palme d'Or winner went on to be a Best Picture nominee, which I don't think that's happened in many years, you know, to have two in a row.
Right.
Here's another question. This happened at the Independent Spirit Awards, too. And David O. Russell actually won an Independent Spirit Award. But at both ceremonies, when they cut to David O. Russell, it was not David O. Russell. It's like they couldn't find him. Like, particularly at the Oscars, when they cut to the Best Director nominees, and they had David O. Russell's camera, it was pointed directly at Emmanuel Riva.
Yeah. Well,
certainly you know that that's not David O. Russell.
I was going to be like, whoa, man, you've changed.
I mean, how was he wearing camouflage or something? They couldn't find him at either of these award ceremonies.
There's something just a tiny bit sort of like anonymous looking about David O. Russell for some reason. Maybe it's the horn-rimmed glasses or something. I don't know what it is, but anyway.
Does he look like Emmanuel Riva? I mean, can he
maybe
be that
one of the same? I mean,
when I met him, he didn't look like Emmanuel Riva, but.
I won't go through the rest of the list, but essentially it boils down to, you know, film festivals play a major role, and because of places like Cannes, that the awards season really does start earlier than we think. I mean, we tend to think it starts like in the fall, but really those prospects make themselves clearer early in the year.
And then it continues all the way to the fall, you know, with the New York Film Festival, which always premieres and ends with something that figures big into the award season as well. So
yeah. Okay, so potential Oscar nominees next year. The Hollywood Reporter posted something.
Oh, okay.
Potentially, John Wells' movie August Osage County. Is that what?
Oh yeah,
Patrick.
Huh? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Meryl Streep, and I believe George Clooney is in that too.
No, I think it's Meryl Streep. Is it Meryl Streep and Julia Roberts? I can't remember.
Yeah, Julia Roberts is in it.
I don't think Clooney is in that one. He's
where did
not,
I read
not
Clooney
then.
Was in it? I read somewhere that he was, but he's not. It's Ewan McGregor, Abigail Breslin, Meryl Streep, Julia Roberts, Juliette Lewis, Dermot Mulroney, Chris Cooper, Sam Shepard. Written by Tracy Letts, who wrote Bug and Killer Joe.
Mm-hmm. That's what he won his Pulitzer for.
Yeah. Bennett Miller has an upcoming film called Foxcatcher.
Mm-hmm.
Channing Tatum, Steve Carell, Mark Ruffalo. You might think Steve Carell, it must be a comedy, but it sure doesn't sound like one. The story of John DuPont, who suffered from paranoid schizophrenia and killed Olympic wrestler David Schultz.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. Okay. Wow. They made that into a movie? Okay.
And actually, Steve Carell plays the lead character, John DuPont.
Oh, this is going to be a major, this could be a major turning point for him. Wow.
Steve Carell, we could be looking at a best actor nominee for him next year.
Okay, well, I'm curious. What are some of the others that they have on there?
Alexander Payne's Nebraska.
Oh, that, mm-hmm.
Now, doesn't that have Bruce Dern in it? Isn't Bruce Dern the lead?
Black and white road movie starring Bruce Dern, yes.
Boy, that could be, talk about a comeback.
Yeah, that screams Oscar. That screams, artsy.
Mm-hmm.
But I like Alexander Payne's movies, actually. So.
Is Mud on there?
Not yet.
Okay.
George Clooney's Monuments Men,
yeah.
I think that he's directing and starring in. And they love George Clooney. So something that just premiered out of Sundance and actually got the most praise from Sundance, Fruitvale.
Oh, yeah.
Could be
that
this year's.
That seems to be the one that's Best place to have is buzz that's going to continue to the Oscars.
Yeah, two Tom Hanks movies. So Tom Hanks could be an Oscar nominee next year, and these could be nominated for Best Picture. There's Captain Phillips, which is directed by Paul Greengrass, and it's about the hijacking of by Somali pirates of the cargo ship.
Okay.
Yeah. And then we have Saving Mr. Banks, which is the John Lee Hancock movie where Tom Hanks plays Walt Disney. I think that's the movie.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is. Yeah, that is the movie.
Yeah, I don't know. Captain Phillips sounds pretty dang good, right?
They
there. With the screenplay by Billy Ray, who did Shattered Glass.
Yeah. Gosh, I love Billy Ray. But you cut off the Cyrus from that, and I love Billy Ray. Martin Scorsese's Wolf of Wall Street, of course, the DiCaprio movie. They're still shooting that movie.
Oh, then the other DiCaprio movie, The Great Gatsby, is, I would imagine.
Possibly.
That's the one that has the big, we don't know about this one, though. Everybody's still going,
that's a big question mark. Coen Brothers inside the Llewyn Davis.
Right.
That just smacks of being, maybe too cool or maybe too just, but I mean, so did A Serious Man, and it got a picture and screenplay nomination.
Right.
Yeah, they definitely love the Coen Brothers. There's Jason Reitman's new film, Labor Day. Josh Brolin, Kate Winslet, Tobey Maguire, and he's always kind of reliable for Oscar caliber.
Yeah, no, he is. So,
depressed single mom Adele and her son Henry offer a wounded, fearsome man a ride as police search the town for the escaped convict. The mother and son gradually learn his true stories as their options become increasingly limited.
Mm-hmm.
Makes it sound like a thriller, which makes me wonder, how would Jason Reitman do with a thriller?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
There's a couple of thrillers in there, I don't think that they respond, the Academy responds well to thrillers generally. So, you have Danny Boyle's Trance, then you have that Brad Pitt movie, The Counselor.
A thriller won Best Picture this year.
That's possible.
Well, that was a historical story.
Yeah,
I'm talking about, that was kind of.
What about Stoker?
Too, but
Yeah, Stoker won't get Oscar love, but I'm looking forward to seeing it.
Yeah, and what about the other one? Is another the Tommy Lee Jones one, Emperor? Is that even on anybody's radar? Or?
I don't know how good that is. They just started screening that. Yeah, so, but I don't know if the movie's good enough to. Maybe it's an Iron Lady thing. Maybe the movie doesn't have to be good enough if Tommy Lee Jones.
But it's coming out in March, and the chances of it really being remembered, even
yeah.
if it's good, I mean, that's a long shot. Just
Alfonso Cuarón's Gravity, which is another big question mark. But gosh, I can't wait to see this movie. All
mm-hmm.
the stuff I've heard about it
right.
and all that.
You know. I think everybody's dying to see that film, and I mean,
which,
you know,
another.
They're not dying to see Oblivion.
I mean, and you know, Sandra Bullock is, you know, rumored to be incredibly
the great in that. Yeah, yeah. Steve McQueen's 12 Years a Slave. Make
oh, that is the one that, yeah.
Yeah.
Yet another Brad Pitt.
Possibly Richard Linklater's. Possibly Richard Linklater's movie Before Midnight.
That's possible.
I mean, I think you can just go on and pencil that in for a screenplay nomination.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And then David O. Russell has another movie that'll be out this year.
Well, that's on the fast track.
Yeah.
That's
working with
Jennifer
Lawrence Africa. Again. Yeah.
And what about Wes Anderson? Will his new film be ready this year? Or?
I'm not sure
about that being ready yet.
Okay.
I'll tell you one thing. Francis Ha will be in the conversation next year. The Noah Baumbach thing. I guarantee you. It will be in.
When's
the
it
going to
come out, though? When's it going to come out?
It comes out in May, in late May.
Okay.
So
well,
all right.
That,
really
that could work. Okay.
So that's definitely going to be in there for a screenplay or an actress nomination. I almost guarantee it.
And there's a movie called Parkland.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Which is about Parkland Hospital on the day Kennedy was shot. And that's got a big cast associated with it.
Bobby had a big cast.
Yeah, exactly. It could be a Bobby.
And so does the butler also do.
Oh, God. Oh, God, the butler's coming. Yes, that. Oh, I can't wait to see that.
To me, that's a big question mark, too. That's just like, okay, well,
there
we're
you
just
going,
gonna wait
you
to go in
drunk or stoned and just enjoy yourself, I think.
Anyway, so that's what we're looking at.
All right, wow.
So what would be the main note that you'd give the producers of next year's ceremony?
Lay off the sauce. I don't know. We say this every year. I don't know at this point. They're so fixated on the host, it seems, in recent years. They don't...
That's it.
I mean,
forget about the host. That's it. Forget about the host.
Well, there have been previous years where there's been no host, obviously, and they were high rated. They made a list of the highest rated to the lowest rated Oscar telecasts since the Nielsens have been around, and quite a few of them up near the top have been hostless. Of course, the number one was the year Titanic swept. And a big reason why this year was successful, possibly, in terms of ratings, was because the movies were very successful. I mean, eight
right.
of the nine movies were over $100 million grossers.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. That's
for
very
Best Picture.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you can't just all chalk it up to just, you know, Seth MacFarlane
no,
and
no,
the
you
Family
can't.
Guy
you,
audience.
I don't even know if that really even matter. You know, like I said, I don't get so fixated on the host. Just worry about, like, try to streamline the show. Try to make it move.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's something I noticed. It really dragged this year. Maybe it wasn't the longest show, but it sure felt like it.
Well, you know, I mean, my main note for me would be just to, you know, in addition to, you know, forget about the hosts and stuff, but just just pay attention to the movies, you know. I mean, I'm just going to read something that I wrote here. It's, as for the ceremony, I want to see a bona fide film expert as a producer, not just a movie TV producer, but maybe a historian. Or how about Kevin Brownlow, for instance, who's an Oscar winner, a historian, and a filmmaker, and a producer. You know, I want to see, you know, film clips and mini documentaries like Errol Morris did a few years ago. I want to see all the best song nominees performed by the original artist. I want to see production sketches next to the costume and production design nominees. I like the script drop-ins that were done for the screenplay nominees in the past years, also missing this year. I want to hear a medley of the best score nominees. I want the honorary Oscars to be reinstated as a feature of the larger award show with speeches and all, and I want there still to be at least 3 honorary Oscars per year. The in memoriam segment needs to be longer. You know, I don't care how long the show goes. Make it as long as the Super Bowl, which goes on for 5 hours. I don't care. I'm a movie fan. I'll be there to the end, and I'm not the only one. I'm one of billions. So, you know, and it's one night a year. It's the only show that's devoted solely to the movies. I think it deserves it.
I mean, it's also the last awards telecast.
Right.
You've already been bombarded with a dozen of them.
Well, that's one of the problems, too. Let's be honest. That's another one of the problems that makes the show seem long. Because we've been through this big, long slog of them.
If the Oscars came out first, all those other award shows would be completely obsolete.
Right.
Nobody would care to watch it. Who would care about watching the SAG or the Golden Globes after the Oscars?
Well, they should move them to, like, January 14th, and then move all of the releases of the Oscar movies up to September or even earlier, August, September, October, November, and then have the voting start in December. Move the thing up to January 10th or 14th or something like that, and then kill all the rest of those things. That's what I would do. I would be scorched earth policy.
I don't know. I honestly don't even know anymore.
Okay, I think we got a caller from Mississippi. Let's see if this is a prank. We have 662 area code.
Yeah, let's see, bro.
Hey, how are you?
Hey, how's it going tonight?
Not bad.
Good, good. Look, basically, I just want to say, like, I'm an American, and I'm serving in the military, and I can suck my own.
I thought that was what it was. Wow.
What is it with our show? What is it with our show?
I think that's that same guy. I think that's that guy. You need to make a note of these numbers. Make a note of the numbers, and then, therefore,
he's just desperate to talk to somebody about it. I mean, I guess it's not getting enough attention.
Is it the guy from Girls?
Well, he is a member of the military, so I guess that's why.
Yeah. That was his way of saying, please be respectful of me, because I'm about to talk about my...
That's one of the guys that they talked about in Invisible War.
Yeah.
Oh, God, yeah. I mean,
America's finest.
Wow, that's just...
Well, let me say this about upcoming shows. We'll be back Sunday. We'll have actor Ed Harris.
Oh,
and we'll also have Nate Segalov, who just wrote a book on the last films of 50 great directors, so we'll be discussing that topic as well. On Wednesday night, we'll be welcoming on director Susan Seidelman, which I talked to her today, and it was a lovely conversation. She was great. And then another conversation I'm really happy with, Glenn Frankel, who just wrote a book on the making of The Searchers, the classic
film. Oh, sweet.
Western. So that'll be a great show, too. So two can't-miss shows coming up Sunday and Wednesday. Sunday at 6 p.m. Eastern, next Wednesday at 10 p.m. Eastern. We'll go ahead and do a show, and I'm hanging up on these prank callers. They keep calling back in. You know, idiots, I actually got to pick up your phone line for you to be heard on the show. And if you think I'm going to do that, then you're even dumber than I thought.
And Matt's saying something.
Yeah, you're dumber than I think. But I don't even know how you manage to stay breathing.
You don't even have enough brains to keep a chicken alive.
Yeah, okay. this guy's number is, I exited out. I would have given out his number so everyone can prank call him. Wouldn't that be great if I gave out his number and asked all of our listeners to call and prank call him?
Next time, make a note of the number, write it down, you know, whenever somebody calls it, because you always suspect it's going to be a prank.
Yeah.
Oh, well, at least you know that it's a live show.
Yeah, this is why we haven't done this in a while.
I think two live shows in a row, that's enough.
God bless our listeners.
Like
they remind
show.
Us right away why we don't do live shows. All right. So we'll be back on Sunday night at 6 o'clock. Thank you, guys.
All right, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone, for tuning in.